Hi everybody, my name is Nicola Maurizi. I'm a cardiologist working in the University Hospital of Lausanne in Switzerland, and I'd like to welcome you on the second episode of HCM Pills. It's a series of webcasts sponsored by the HCM Patient Foundation, a non-profit organization aimed at providing information and structuring the care of patients around Europe. And today I have the pleasure of having here next to me a friend, a mentor, Professor Iacopo Olivotto, working at Meyer's University Hospital in Florence. And Iacopo, you're driving the innovation in the treatment of this disease. But let's go back to something that are very important question for our daily life and seeing patients. So how hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is usually diagnosed?
As you know, Nicolo, when patients come to us at the sort of tertiary referral center for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, there are basically three main mechanisms where or pathways that lead to diagnosis. The first is the finding of a funny looking ECG or an abnormal echocardiogram, which has been requested either due to symptoms or because of sports medicine screening or other kinds of screening, routine preoperative sort of evaluations and so on. Some of these patients have been around for a while with these funny looking ECGs and nobody has given them a response until they are directed to the center. But more and more, we already find cardiologists in the regional sort of hubs that are identifying the disease properly and sending them already almost with a tag, with a diagnosis. The second big chapter, although fortunately is smaller than the other one, is events. So patients presenting due to acute heart failure, sustained arrhythmias, like for example, atrial fibrillation, leading to the emergency room, unfortunately, cardiac arrest or syncope, which are of course the most important. These are, I would say, probably about a quarter of these patients. And of course, that is, there's a central event, as we call it, which eventually leads to medical attention. Then we have another increasing group of patients that are the relatives of patients who already have a diagnosis and are being screened for the disease in the family. And of course, there you are going to look specifically for abnormalities which may highlight the disease that's already present in a relative. So it's usually a faster diagnosis.
Yeah. Well, it's a very interesting perspective. So we have a lot of tools to diagnose our patients. Do you think there are certain tools, certain exams that are more sensitive with respect to others or not?
Well, of course, the gold standard for diagnosis is an imaging test. So you would need to have a proper diagnosis, you need to have an echo and possibly a cardiac magnetic resonance. So echocardiography and cardiac magnetic resonance. Cardiac magnetic resonance is only adding about 5 to 10% to what an echo says. So if you don't have an MRI, don't go crazy about it, because the echo tells us a lot of things, and this is the gold standard. However, if you talk about screening and being sensitive, for example, if you're looking in very young individuals who have HCM relatives and you want to screen for that, the ECG, the classic and cheap 12-lead electrocardiogram works really quite well. It doesn't allow a diagnosis, so there is no 100% specific ECG, but the ECG raises the suspicion. What is really specific then is the echo and the MRI. And from there, you have to have additional tests that will allow you to identify the specific kind of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and whether it's proper hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, so related to a sarcomere gene mutation or a funny, small, rarer disease like Fabry or Danon, or rather what we call copies of the disease itself. So testing may take a long time and you may need to have extra, very sophisticated tests, but on average, most of our patients, the vast majority of our patients, can be diagnosed just by a good medical history, a good ECG, and a good echocardiogram. So something any cardiologist can do.
Totally agree with that. So we have diagnosis, the patient is diagnosed, and now it begins a sort of a chronic disease. So how often the patient should see a cardiologist? And where, in your opinion?
Yes, that's what I try to tell to patients. When they have a new diagnosis, of course, patients are very afraid, very scared. They think the disease is going to be like a sword fight. And I tell to them, no, this is not a This is not an acute fight. This is a game of chess. You really have to move your pieces around, very thinking about every move, and it takes time to make the right decisions. And you have to learn to live with the disease and try to make sure that the disease has the least possible impact on your whole life. So in order to do this, of course, you have a big baseline evaluation. First evaluation takes time and requires a lot of testing. After that, we usually see patients which are not complicated about once a year. And if patients are sicker or have evolving treatments that we need to monitor or are considered for surgery or for devices, like a defibrillator, in this case, we see them more often, every 6 or even every 3 months.
Yeah, that's very good. So at every follow-up, just a practical question, do you think there is a certain exam that needs to be performed every time and others that need to be more spaced in time?
Yes, again, so the basics are, again, medical history, incredibly important, examination, so the very sort of standard ECG and echocardiogram. These need to be performed at every visit. We also like to have every year have a Holter ECG monitor to check for arrhythmias, and we like to check the some biomarkers. So these are hormones or proteins that are in the blood, which can give us an impression of what's going on during sort of in the chronic setting. So proBNP, many will be familiar with this, which is a hormone which raises in cases of heart failure, and troponin T, which is a marker of cell sufferance, self-death. Then we perform more sophisticated but more invasive tests like MRI or exercise testing only about 1 every 5 years. So if there's no major clinical change, a patient is stable, we can do an MRI every 5 years and an exercise echo possibly every 5 years.
Yeah, that's the driving spirit behind is that an exam shall answer a question. So if you don't have a question, don't ask for crazy sophisticated exam otherwise.
Yes, this is the principle of good clinical practice, two things. First of all, you have to have a question you ask. And second, every test, particularly if the test is expensive or invasive or potentially has hazards, the test must be very indecisive for a therapeutic decision.
Yeah.
So every test should lead you to modify or potentially modify treatment. If that is not just to do a test just because you want to know something, is not good.
Yeah. So we're really at a sort of a paradigm shift in our world, Iacopo. For the first time, the EC, and you were a great part of this, published the first guidelines on cardiomyopathies. So guidelines are documents from an official society that describe a good clinical practice with patients with a certain disease. How do you think this will impact the patient care at European level?
Well, first of all, as you say, these particular guidelines, which are the 2023 European Society of Cardiology guidelines for the management of cardiomyopathies, is a historical document, because for the first time, these guidelines do not assess a single disease as many before, like hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, arrhythmogenic, dilated. But for the first time, we present our community of physicians, of healthcare providers, and patients as a single community with cardiomyopathy. So just to make the larger community realize that this is an important epidemiological and social problem, apart from being an important medical problem. So the initial part of this document is a compendium of the common problems that all these patients have, even if they have very different diseases. Somebody with dilated cardiomyopathy or with Fabry disease or with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, many of these have the same problems. So genetic testing, genetic transmission, psychological impact, people wanting to do sports, what can I do? People wanting to buy a house or to do a profession, what can I do? Lack of treatment, lack of studies, how do we design a proper study, and so on. So this is the first sort of introduction, and then the guidelines go on with specific sections looking at different diseases in the specific setting this time. But at the end, there's again a sort of like a fresco of what the future should be. And so I think the big impact in terms of research and treatment discovery. So I think the real impact of these guidelines are to bring cardiomyopathies to the forefront of the cardiological sort of society priorities, and maybe also present these priorities to the political world, to the healthcare providers, in a sort of a much stronger stance, as opposed to going there separately with every different disease going their own way, which is what we have been doing for many years.
So, talking about future, you are one of the guys shaping the future of this disease. And in your opinion, which is one of the most exciting new treatment in the field of cardiomyopathy that have been discovered or will be discovered shortly?
Well, the field is undergoing incredible advances in the last five years. So I think, first of all, the first and incredibly amazing advancement is that for the first time we're now doing trials, and we, the number of sort of trials that are ongoing in the last 10 years has multiplied by tenfold in this field of cardiomyopathy at large, and in specifically in HCM. We have begun to identify molecular targets, so therapeutic targets, which means that we now know, because we have studied the diseases so much and so long, for such a long time, we now know which are the potential targets where our sort of magic bullets might hit in order to treat this disease, very specifically, not any disease, only that disease. And this is really crucial. So these molecules are being now developed in increasing numbers. Of course, we're now facing for the first time the problems with drug development. Drug development is incredibly expensive. Of 100 drugs, molecules that start the process, only one maybe reaches the market, and the cost is millions and millions. So luckily, we are seeing investments. We are seeing increasing interest from startups, companies, industry. Even the big pharma are now acquiring rare diseases branches that are growing quickly. So, of course, the next frontier will be to show that these drugs work, to be able to design the trials that show benefit in the patient. And patients here play a big role, because now a lot of these drugs will be defined by endpoints, which means proofs of efficacy that are patient-based. So what the regulators want to know before they can pay for this drug is, does the drug fulfill patients' expectation? Not just physicians' expectation, but patients' expectation. Patients are now on the board of major trials. They are increasingly organizing themselves into societies, and they are now contributing very, very actively to research, pretty much like in some other sort of fields, like, for example, cystic fibrosis is a best example. And of course, the frontier will be to end up from having these silver bullet, magic bullets, to actually trying to cure diseases with gene therapy. There is huge expectation on that. I think maybe now too big for the moment. It needs caution. But of course, we are beginning to see the start of this process, where we can also target some specific individual patients with rare diseases that are consistently severe and malignant, and be able to cure the genetic defect. This is really work for the next couple of decades.
Absolutely agree. So for the last question, let's just go back to the very simple clinical ground. When you see a patient, do you think there is some aspect of this disease that might impact their life? And how should they cope with that? And how should they live with that?
Of course, the disease impacts very profoundly patients. I would say there are two different scenarios. The first scenario is when the disease is actually impacting in an objective manner the patients, because they are sick, they have symptoms, they need aggressive treatment, they may need surgery, they may need a device, or they have had somebody in the family who was ill and suffer from the disease. This is objective and in a way quantifiable, and also sort of quite logic. Then there is another, unfortunately quite large section of patients where the impact is mostly psychological and social. This is because of bad communication, stigma, because a lot of the physicians, the healthcare providers, are not sufficiently expert in the disease and may sort of scare patients too much or neglect patients. And because there is not enough has been done to really create a sort of psychological support for patients following a diagnosis. It's very important to remember that many of our patients with current treatment can now lead a normal life and have a very good life expectancy. So the worst that can happen to them is that physicians make their life worse than it would be without having any diagnosis at all. And this is, of course, something that we are always very cautious about. So making sure that patients get the most of their lives, and this is often quite a lot.
Let's finish up with this very positive message that, you know, research is exploding. The environment is really a positive environment in all the aspects, from research development to treatment in patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. I thank you very much, Iacopo. I believe patients will enjoy that very much, your insight into the world of cardiomyopathy. So I'll close the second HCM Pill episode. And remember to comment and to share this video, and to comment also to drive our next webcast on meaningful questions that are meaningful for yourself and your disease as well. And I thank you very much.